Welcome everybody. At a time when we have collectively pressed the global pause button, we have yet another day to celebrate, the World Environment Day 2020. It is no wonder that the theme for this year is biodiversity. The Dope, an online travel magazine, as a principle embraces sustainability and in its features and reporting aims to circle back to our collective responsibility as an industry towards this cause. The World Environment Day is one of the biggest days of recognition for encouraging people worldwide to save and protect our environment from different environmental challenges that the world faces today. The World Environment Day is also a People's Day, which is why encouraging all of you, both as travelers and as industry people, to put in your mind and your thoughts behind how you can rework your businesses with environment and earth as the center of everything that you do as a business. World Environment Day is the biggest annual event in the world run by United Nations to mark the environmental awareness among people. Its main aim is to raise awareness to protect our nature and look at various environment issues that are growing day upon day. In this scenario, post-COVID, I think we are all a part of this conversation. We all have become increasingly aware of what we can just, all of us together can do if we can only pause a bit. On the eve of the World Environment Day, we have Dr. Latika Nath, India's foremost tiger biologist, conservation ecologist and photographer, an avid wildlife photographer and also a creative art photographer. Not many people have seen those photographs of hers, but I just love them. Author, an articulate advocate for the case of conservation, for the case of conservation-based tourism. Also an intrepid traveler. I mean, she can write several books on travel to various parts of the world. She's also a diver and also an underwater photographer. And one of the foremost things, and which is how she came into my life, is also she is a very, very creative hotelier. Welcome, Latika. Welcome to the first in the series of interviews that we are doing with people from the industry, especially in the field of conservation and wildlife. Welcome on board.
Thank you. Such a pleasure. Such a privilege.
Latika, let's just begin with the basic question. I mean, in the last 2 months, there have been so many Earth Day, environment. I mean, of course, we're coming up with the Environment Day. There have been day for this, the Marine Conservation Day. What is the significance and what is the need for a day like this?
So I think basically this is the world acknowledging that they were going wrong and that there's a new way of living, that we need to be in sync with nature. We need to let the whole system guide us as to how we can coexist as a part of the system, not as around us, but a part and parcel of the system with the same issues as the other denizens of this world. And I think this is the new awareness that is coming in with Gen X, with Gen Z, with the now the new generations that are coming up, Gen Alpha and things like that. So I think this is just an acknowledgement of how wrong we were going. We were becoming a use and discard society, which just doesn't work because we live on a finite world with limited resources.
Yeah, like they say, just we have only planet Earth. We don't have a plan B.
No.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So when we talk about biodiversity, I mean, because they're going to be a lot of people here, those who work in the wildlife and environment areas, and also those who are completely new to the whole idea of what we actually mean when we say biodiversity. How would you describe as biodiversity? What would you describe as biodiversity? And what is a healthy biodiversity region?
Okay, so biodiversity is really the variety of living organisms in an area, in a habitat, in a space, in a country, in our world. So we have tens of thousands of species. When a broad number of different types of these species exist in an area, it's called a biodiverse area. The more the mixture, the merrier the mixture, the happier it is.
One of the things that you also did when you, when you used to run a lodge in Central India, was this whole idea of rewilding. Mm-hmm. You know, that you just allowed the local, the local species of trees, plants, creepers, herbs, everything to kind of grow into profusion, into natural profusion. That is one of the things that we really endorse. So, how would you? Rather than plant exotic plants and trees and, create these landscape gardens, how would you encourage people to, especially lodge owners and people who are living, how would you encourage this whole idea of rewilding?
So I think especially we're now looking just first at safari and wildlife lodges. I think one of the most important things that I keep repeating to people is that you have guests coming to you for a wild experience. It's about being out there in nature as nature is. It's not about going into a landscape piece of perfection, with a little handkerchief manicured garden and three pretty flowers and four pretty trees. It's not about that. So the idea is that you allow the birds and the bees literally to come back and repollinate and resurrect the natural ubiquitous flora that you see around you, the indigenous species, and you actively remove exotic invasives. So I would encourage people to remove things like lantana, which take up the natural undergrowth and prevent the natural species from coming back, and many other species which we find like parthenium, which have grown in all of these regions. So, just let it all come back, be wild. And if you're really, really enthusiastic, start a nursery with the help of your local village community. The amount of indigenous knowledge these people have is incredible. Help them to identify and remember which the local medicinal plants are. Start nurseries with them. Help them to plant them and maintain them. Have a follow-up program to make sure that everything you plant actually survives.
And flourishes, yeah.
It should survive to year three. That's really important.
What is the, in India, let's speak about the Indian subcontinent. How serious is our threat to biodiversity and what are the causes?
I think the biggest problem is that planning for the environment and its protection is not an integral part of every development proposal. As a basic rule in India, we do the bare minimum we need to do just to get environmental clearances to get our projects through. We believe in dealing with the problem when it happens, a sort of principle of we'll cross the bridge when we come to it. So we deal with the wound after the wound has happened. We don't deal with prevention. We believe that we can actually maybe even prevent it from happening without actually doing anything. And then when things get really bad, then we panic.
Start to panic.
Then we start to panic. So, being aware of the need for being green, the need for being environmentally responsible, and that it is an integral part of every project. And the planning for this needs to be included in, I would say, 30% of every project should be on environmental protection.
Yeah, the impact that a project might cause, yeah.
Only now we're becoming aware of the impacts of light pollution.
Correct.
The disorientation of birds, the disappearance of bumblebees, how it impacts on insect breeding. We're not even looking at how emitting huge amounts of unnecessary light into space and not having a black sky anymore. We're not looking at how that is impacting on biodiversity. so these are all
imagine we kind of when we all got into lockdown, one of the first things that we said, oh, there is a blue sky in Delhi. I mean, never seen a blue sky in Delhi, always this gray, gloomy gray sky.
And all these reports of being able to see so-and-so mountain range from 200 kilometers away, and being able to see the Everest, and I mean all sorts of reports. But the scary thing is it's a temporary pause.
And when they're talking about bouncing back, that's what is very scary.
And it'll be a real bounce. I mean,
go back with an extra force. So, Latika, the way I mean, our viewers of Dope will also be travelers, and they'll also be tour operators, people in the travel business, and they're obviously they'll be hospitality professionals. How can each of us, as a traveler, as a business professional, how can each of us help to preserve our biodiversity hotspots?
Okay, so I think there are many aspects to this, and I'd like to take up two or three important points for me. One is, I think you need to identify and understand that overcrowding is a huge issue. If you have a whole crowd of people arriving at one spot at a particular time, in India, case in point, the holidays. The parks just burst at the seams. There's no jeeps to be had. There, every seat is taken, and there are 200 vehicles in the park. That destroys the whole reason for you being in the outdoors. Okay, so the experience is not nice. It's also a huge impact on the national park itself, because there's fumes, there's sound, there's people, there's resource use intensive.
Which typically belongs to the land and its people.
Yes, absolutely. And you know, overuse of water, overuse, creation of waste, all of those things will happen there. So I say that when you start to travel now, from today onwards, it's really important that you try and go to offbeat places, pick times when it is not a peak holiday season. Try and do longer holidays so that you actually get immersive experiences of where you're going, and you get to make bonds and understand what the life is like there. So you come back enriched and with memories that lifelong stay with you and change you as a person. So these quick trips, if there's no other choice, yes, you have to do them, you have to do them. But the ideal holiday is to do a little longer stay. Where your choice of lodge is concerned, I understand that people have restrictions on budgets. But remember that most often, unfortunately today, environmentally friendly and sustainable lodges tend to have to spend a little more on technologies that allow them to be green and sustainable. So their tariffs might be a little higher. You need to understand this, and you need to appreciate what they are doing. Please support these institutions in going that extra mile, because they're really trying hard. The personal interaction in these places makes them really, really special. And I think this is where the future of travel lies. Yeah. So I think that's where we need to go.
Yeah. And one of the things that when you were running a lodge in Central India, and I'm looking forward to the lodge that's coming up now, is the activities that you created, is the festivals you created. You know, that, in my opinion, not only it changed traveler mindsets. If you remember, you did that. You instituted this lovely festival on celebrating trees. Let's talk about it. The whole idea about that, and which I think is a great, festivals, I think, are a great idea to put out, to put out ideas and transformative experiences.
Yeah. So I think, you know, it came about from the fact that a lot of people talk about the local indigenous communities. And in Central India, we're very blessed to have several of these incredible communities. They're in other parts of the country as well. But I was just happened to be in Central India, and we have the Baiga and the Gond communities, the Ahirs, and there's a whole section. Some of these are better known, like the Gonds, for their painting. And the world has been focusing only on that aspect. And I thought it was really important to talk about the Baiga knowledge of nature, the food and the cuisine of these communities, and how they use plants and herbs found in the forest that we would never normally look at.
Yes.
You know, and to talk about their musical instruments, their dance, the art of oral storytelling, and the bards.
Yes.
You know, that was really important. So I thought it would be a celebration of their existence, a celebration of the fact that we get to live next to them and benefit from the knowledge that they share with us. And so we created this festival called Trees in Their Lives, because every single Gond painting that you see is based on a tree. There is always a tree somewhere in the picture. So that was where we said Trees in Their Lives, because for them there are trees that they worship, trees where the forest gods live, trees where they will go and celebrate. You know, the Madai festival that they do is always around a big tree. So we created this festival called Trees in Their Lives, and to my absolute amazement, we had between 200 and 300 people coming from these communities to participate. So it was a festival,
and also artists
awesome for them, and the tourism, the tourists were actually just maybe a very small handful. You know, 30 people,
absolutely.
But 300 tribals celebrating themselves.
Absolutely.
The other thing that we did every year was shut the lodge down for 3 days. And we actually went out. There are a number of villages that are exist in the buffer zones of protected areas in India. And in our case, we have more than 80 villages. And every year we would go to 5 and get the 5 best students from every village school, from targeting primarily the middle and the primary schools.
Yes.
So 5 best students, and they would come and they would be guests in this luxury boutique lodge. And experience what life was like on the other side of the fence.
Absolutely.
They would never, normally it's just they hear stories from their families, from elders who have worked in these lodges.
Absolutely.
But to be a guest, to live in the guest rooms, to have the full experience, and to go into the park with trained naturalist guides who spend time explaining how the world worked around them. To learn about the plants and the animals and the birds and the insects and the grass, and
why they should be protecting the tiger as their heritage,
and what they were the protectors of.
Oh, absolutely.
You know, so that was, I think, an incredible moment.
You've traveled quite a bit. You've traveled all over the world, and I know that I don't think there are many areas in the world, the biodiversity hotspots in the world, that have escaped the human hand, but there must still be areas which have been protected thanks to their governments or the local communities. Can you tell me a couple of them that you've been completely taken by surprise and
despite all the bad press that's being generated right now, I think one of the most magical countries in the world is Brazil.
Yes.
And they've got an incredible heritage with the Amazon and the Amazon forests. And it's a huge country, and it's unbelievable. I mean, there's no words to describe the magnificence of the Amazon. It's just amazing. The same way I feel that the entire Mekong region, there are just some amazing places and gems and biodiversity hotspots that you just never see. The northeast of India, Arunachal.
Yes, yeah, I was, yeah.
Magical beyond words.
I've seen your photographs from there. Oh, yeah. Beautiful. Mm-hmm. What is one of your best photographing moments? You know, what is that one time when you said, oh my God, and you had tears in your eyes after that?
Well, I couldn't have tears in my eyes, but I think one of the latest extraordinary moments for me was when I was in the Galapagos. And, you know, with 400 sharks around me and this big pregnant female whale shark, she was about 18 meters long. And you were in the middle of the ocean, and literally in the middle of the ocean, you were in the blue. And you got, I had this female on one side and I had another shark on the other side, and I was in the middle. And these gentle giants, and they carried on forever there. I mean, 16, 18 meters is like three buses long, you know?
Wow.
And it's like, it's huge, and it shows you you're nothing, because you're this little speck around this giant, yeah. And then they just accept you, and there's, you're there, and this Zen moment happening, you know, and it was magical.
Amazing.
And the water and these hammerheads just sort of swimming by in these circles, you know. Yes. I mean, it was just, it was like being in a huge IMAX theater. I mean, yeah. I couldn't believe that it was real, and I could put out my...
Could you put your hand and touch them? Yeah.
It was amazing. And to see that sort of biodiversity exists was incredible. And now it just breaks my heart because there was this big oil spill there and, you know, all of this. And then Ecuador has been so badly hit by the corona epidemic. They really need all the help that they can. I mean, that country is just incredible as well. So, yeah.
Thank you, Latika. Thank you for joining us today in celebration of the World Environment Day. You heard Latika and the wonders and the beauty of our environment and the planet. And like she said, if we are cognizant of the fact that we are but a speck of nature, and we live with the environment, not against the environment, I don't think we need to pick a day for the World Environment Day or as a day dedicated to nature. Every day would be the World Environment Day. Thank you.